We will be discussing a case of a 60 years old male who presented with dizziness for the past 3 days. This is the ECG of the patient. Now this ECG was done in the emergency, and what we can see is that this is a bradyarrhythmia. If you grossly see it, this appears to be a bradyarrhythmia. Now there are two possibilities for a bradyarrhythmia. One is a sinus node dysfunction and the other is the AV block. Now let us see whether this is an AV block or a sinus node dysfunction. So first of all, we have to identify the P waves. This is a very important step, because sometimes the AV blocks can be seen in tachyarrhythmias as well, like atrial tachycardias. But now we have to identify whether these are P waves or not. So look at these. What do you think? Are they P waves or not? So let us see. These are the P waves, but now are these the sinus P waves or not? So for that we have to see all the 12 lead ECG. So let's start from lead 1. So we can see that the P waves are there and they are upright. So they are upright in 1, 2, 3 AVF, and they are negative in AVR. And they are also positive in the interior chest leads. So all in all, this suggests that these are the sinus P waves. Okay, so now what is next? We have to see what is the rate. So this rate is sometime around 90 to 100 beats per minute. Okay, so the P to P rate, the sinus rate, is around 90 to 100 beats per minute. So it is not that fast. Now next we have to see the morphology and the rate and the conduction into the QRS. For that we have to see the lead V1, because that is the lead which shows the morphology. That is very important to identify the QRS morphology in lead V1 over here. Okay, so okay, now I have marked the arrows for you to see. So these two things, or these two points, are very important now. So first of all, let's come to lead V1. So what do you think is happening over here? Is this a healthy looking or normal looking QRS morphology? No, this is not a routine QRS morphology which you see in a sinus rhythm. So what is this? So as you can see, this is an R, S and R pattern, and it has some width in it, so it is broad. So this suggests that this complex in V1 is a right bundle branch block. So this patient is having right bundle branch block. So now look at late lead AVF. So as you see that the AVF is also utilized in identifying the axis. So this AVF is negative. So this means he is having some kind of axis deviation as well. So he is having right bundle branch block and he is having left interior fascicular block. So for a right bundle branch block, there should not be a left interior fascicular block. So this means there is something going on with the left bundle branch block as well. So one fascicle of the left bundle branch is blocked. So how do you know that? What are the features of a left interior fascicular block? So now I have marked, written these features for you over here. So let's apply these features for a left interior fascicular block. So left interior fascicular block, first of all, left axis deviation. So AVF is negative, no doubt about it. Now there are QR complexes in lead 1 and AVL. So now let's come to lead 1 and AVL. So as you can see, they have a predominant R waves over here, and very tiny Q waves, very tiny. If you can see it carefully, you can see a very small negative hump, but this is significant. So there are QR complexes in lead 1 and AVL, and there should be an RS. So small R and a big S in inferior leads. So let's apply it over here. So this is a small R and a deep S. Okay, similar over here as well. and obviously in AVF as well. So these features of left anterior fascicular block are being fulfilled over here. What's next? So overall, up till now, what we have seen is that this patient is having a sinus rhythm. He is having evidence of infranodal conduction disease in the form of right bundle branch block and left anterior fascicular block. So obviously this has something to do with the conduction system below the AV node. So now we have to be very careful. What next? So now look at these arrows. So this is very clear, there is no doubt about it, that there are two P waves which are not being conducted into the QRS complexes. So they have a very important significance. So, and you can also see that in most other areas, some of the P waves are also not being conducted. So this means some of the P's are not producing QRS complex, they are totally cut off and not conducting downwards, but sometimes they do conduct over here as well. Look at here, over here, over here. So there is an intermittent conduction going on. So what is the reason for this? So the reason for this is high grade AV block. So over here with these arrows marked, this patient, two consecutive P waves are not being conducted, and this goes in the favor of a high degree or a high grade AV block. So this is not an early stage of a block, it is an advanced kind of block, and high grade AV block needs attention. So this P wave is not conducted, this is not conducted, this P wave is again not conducted. Okay, so one thing that is interesting and that is happening over here is, look at this. So what's happening over here? So now we can see this P is conducting into R, this P is again conducting into R with a longer PR interval as compared to this, and this P is not conducted at all, followed by a PR interval that is shortened. Okay, so what is this? So this meets the criteria for a Moberg's type 1 or a AV Wenke back. So in this patient, there is sometimes problem at the AV node and sometimes problem below the AV node, which means infranodal. So he is having a varying kind of conduction issues going on. So now let's summarize the findings which we have seen in this patient. So he's having sinus rhythm, he's having a right bundle branch block, he's having a left anterior fascicular block, he's having an AV Wenke back, and he's having a high grade AV block. So what should you suggest? This patient need pacemaker. So based on the history, based on the age, based of the evidence of an infranodal conduction disease and having symptoms as well, this patient is definitely going for a pacemaker. So this is the treatment for this patient. So now let's study the take home points from this ECG. So we need to identify AV Wenke back, which is a gradual increase of the PR interval followed by a non-conducted P waves. We need to identify a high grade AV block. So when two or more consecutive sinus P waves do not conduct to produce a QRS or a ventricular complex, this is called high degree or high grade AV block. So very important, the sinus rhythm should be identified. So never ever jump directly onto the QRS complexes in bradyarrhythmias. Always look at the sinus node activity. This will save your day. P waves, they should be marked to see whether they are regular or they are irregular in intervals. And P to QRS relationship should be identified. Definitely, this will help you in identifying the type of an AV block. And pacemaker is indicated in any symptomatic patients with AV block. This was all for today. Thank you very much.